Joining the Daily Caller is Enes Kanter-Freedom, Boston Celtics center and longtime human rights advocate. Enes, thanks for joining the program.
Thank you for inviting me, man. I appreciate it.
Enes, I want to kick things off by discussing your defiant stance to raise awareness about human rights violations at the hands of the Chinese government, which the corporate media as of late hasn't really put front and center in their coverage of you. And last week, we saw as footage emerged of Hong Kong universities removing statues that commemorate the Tiananmen Square massacre, in which 10,000 Chinese pro-democracy protesters were killed by their own government. So what is your reaction to the removal of these statues, and why do you think the international community has had a mostly weak response to Chinese aggression?
I'll just start with this. Obviously, what's happened over there, it's heartbreaking. And you see there's so many, countries and governments and people out there are scared to say a word when it comes to China, because obviously there's so much, business involved. There's so much, obviously, economies involved. And it just sad to me because many people, many countries or many, many Muslim leaders out there calling them the social justice warriors and, social justice companies and social justice, countries and stuff. But when it comes to China, they remain silent. When I obviously heard that news, it's heartbreaking. So I feel like we need to do whatever we can to bring awareness.
Yeah, and kind of on that note, as an NBA player, you witnessed as the league forced former Houston Rockets general manager Daryl Morey to apologize for tweeting in support of Hong Kong protests against Chinese government takeover. I actually happened to have a free Hong Kong custom jersey that I was able to get in the NBA store, but it was removed after 3 days.
Oh, wow, and interesting.
So essentially, it's not just the NBA. It's Hollywood, the media, big tech, and even our government is self-censored, kowtowing to China out of fear of financial retribution. And considering the interdependence of the American and Chinese economies, how do you plan to convince people who have something to lose financially to support your advocacy? And what do you think would be accomplished if the entire country united behind your cause?
I mean, while we are talking right now, there is a genocide happening. So it don't matter how much money is involved or how much, when it comes to sport, how much, jersey sales or how much shoe sales or how much business is going on with not just NBA, but like you see this NFL now, this and all the other kind of companies and organizations or associations besides WTA, whatever is involved, it is not more important than, people's life. I sit down with many of the, survivors and had a conversation with them, and I know from firsthand what they've been through. So I think, all this, Wall Street, big tech, academias or trying to think, the Congress, local Congresses, I mean, if they all stand up for what is right, I feel like we are definitely going to have a better future, because it's just so sad that all these people are bowing to, unfortunately, money, they're bowing to power. And I feel like, someone had to go out there and just call out all those people so, we can have a better understanding of what's going on.
Yeah, and also on that note, I remember seeing an interview in which you admitted that teammates jokingly called you Mr. Freedom before it actually became a reality a few weeks ago. And in the past, you've said Americans love to criticize their country without appreciating the freedoms they have here. And to me, I think part of the reason you became Mr. Freedom is because you were disillusioned by your fellow league mates in the NBA bubble wearing those social justice messages on their jerseys, because it was seen as the culturally and politically correct thing to do. But I think changing your name to Freedom symbolizes more than just a slogan on a jersey. So what is your message to Nike athletes like LeBron James and Colin Kaepernick, who are celebrated for claiming to support oppressed groups, but don't use their platform to call out Chinese human rights violations out of fear of suffering financially?
I'll just start with this. Obviously, when 2 years ago, when the league and not just NBA, but the organizations were standing up for the Black Lives Matter, it did give me so much hope and motivation to fight for what's right. And obviously, when it comes to all the China issue, people, and then not just people, you see athletes, rappers, singers, or celebrities, people who have the platform are just remaining silent, and it's heartbreaking. And I feel like before these athletes, we need to call out this companies. you know, the companies like obviously Nike. I'm just giving an example of Nike because it is the biggest, you know, sponsor in NBA. And you look at what Nike stands for in America. You know, it stands for, you know, Black Lives Matter, no Asian hate, Latino community, and but LGBTQ community. But when it comes to China, remain silent. And if I was an athlete, you know, or whoever's athlete watching this interview right now, before you put your signature on this paper and sign in this, you know, millions and millions of dollars contract with this company, do a little research. You know, I do want to, you know, emphasize about, you know, whenever you buy shoes or you buy those, you know, jerseys, or whenever you buy this t-shirts, there are so much blood and sweat and oppression behind those items. So I feel like, you know, before the Zathis, we definitely need to call out those companies, and athletes definitely need to educate themselves about what's going on.
And kind of getting back to that question I asked earlier about the interdependence of the American and Chinese economies, you're mentioning Nike. We should be wary of supporting a company that has used Uyghur slave labor or has manufacturing in China. What about every other product that we use on a daily basis? I mean, you use an iPhone, I use an iPhone. We have
I actually did just buy another phone. It's actually ordered in my calendar right now. And I just had to start setting it up. But I feel like, you know, once when you pick up a product and when you look and it says made in China, just put that back. You know, that's what I will tell. I've been telling all my friends. I've been telling all my, you know, not just people in NBA, but like in different organizations, different associations and athletes. If you pick up an item and it says made in China, put that back, because obviously we are trying to stand up for something. And if we are using any kind of product that made in China, it will be very hypocrisy of us. So I feel like we definitely need to be careful of, you know, what made in China or not, what we should use or not.
That's really interesting. And kind of segueing here is, I read your Time piece the other day and I thought it was very well written. And you mentioned something that kind of stuck to me about the culture wars, about how your message is kind of being lost. And what I'm wondering is, both the American political right and left have turned you into this culture war issue. And what have you learned through your experience of appearing across the corporate media landscape, from MSNBC to Fox News? And what has this taught you about our American media complex?
I feel like, you know, we should have one goal. You know, we should have one goal, and that goal is to make this country better together. I mean, it just, sometimes it's sad because you go on, obviously people have different opinions, and that's their freedom. They can have obviously different opinions and stuff. But like, I feel like when it comes to obviously attacking each other, and if people doing this, so this attacking to gain more votes or gain more, you know, retweets or gain more publicity, then it is just not good for the country. I feel like the focus should be, okay, you know, we have different kind of opinions. How can we make this country better together? Not, oh, let me just attack this person and I will get more retweets, or let me just attack this guy or that. If it's for the good cause, if it's for to wake people up, then I'm all for it. But if it's literally just you doing this for PR, that's unacceptable. You know, what I learned, obviously people, I pretty much, you know, join every media outlet. You know, I go on CNN, I go on Fox, I go on MSNBC, I go to come to Daily Caller. But I feel like the important thing is just, if you have a message, and this message is to stand up for people and stand up for human rights, I want every part of the country to hear my message. So I told you this from the beginning, I'm not a Republican or Democrat. I don't have a side. I don't do politics, I do human rights. There's a difference between doing a human rights and politics. But I feel like, you know, a lot of people are sometimes like to criticize me about which show I'm joining or who I'm talking to. But I'm trying to tell people that, like, listen, you know, you might not like the guy or you might love the guy. My job is to get my message out there every part of the country. So, and for an independent guy, so that's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, and I totally agree with that. And that's part of the reason why I think you're going on all these networks is you don't care about where you stand politically. What your message is that human rights, is that freedom, are those American values that you're trying to champion? And something that I find interesting is maybe it's difficult to get your message across on these different platforms when there's conflicting interests. So, for example, this week, an MSNBC producer described Chinese human rights abuses as alleged. And at the same time, the network's coverage of Chinese atrocities has been particularly quiet. And maybe this is due to NBC's multi-billion dollar contract to host the 2022 mm-hmm. Beijing Winter Olympics on their platform. And I'm wondering, how do you navigate getting your message out through legacy media, which may not want to ruffle the feathers of the Chinese government in fear of those major financial hits, like with what happened with the NBA? Mm-hmm.
First of all, I did not know that. That's the first time I actually heard about it. It is very interesting. And for sure, after this interview, I'm definitely going to do more research about it. And if I see something wrong, I'm going to call out. I don't care whoever is doing wrong. You know, if my brother is go out there and do something wrong, I will call him out too. So, you know, if that's the case, it is sad. That's the only thing I can say. But I feel like, you know, one thing I'm trying to do, it doesn't matter who the host is or whoever, that whichever channel I'm doing an interview with, my message is the same. And now the whole world knows, obviously, there's a genocide happening in China and how Chinese government abusing the rights of, you know, Tibetans, Hong Kongers, and, you know, the Uyghurs, and what they're doing to Taiwan and all that stuff. So I feel like, you know, the important thing is just go out there, whoever the host is, just get your message across. You know, don't worry about which channel you're talking to, which this and that, and just go out there and just do what you do.
Yeah, and so we kind of were talking about MSNBC, which is a little left-leaning. And then I think on the right, you've been put on this pedestal primarily because of your pro-America sentiments. And sometimes I'm seeing people champion you as Mr. Freedom, but not really mentioning your human rights advocacy. So is it frustrating when both the right-wing and left-wing media project their predetermined narratives onto you? And do you think being somewhat of a pawn of the culture wars has distracted people from your freedom advocacy in China and around the world?
I mean, that's the reason. My human rights work is the reason that I picked that name, Freedom, you know? So, I mean, the reason I picked that name, because I want all the young kids, all the sports, you know, kids out, fans out there to research that last name. Why did I pick that last name? What was the reason? What I have been through the last, you know, 8-9 years, what my family went through, not just myself, but like what am I trying to do for other people? So that is the reason I picked that, you know, last name. So I hope that whenever they mention that last name, I hope that they will mention all the human rights, you know, work that I've been trying to do, because that work is not for me. It's for the people out there. It's for the, you know, for the innocent people I'm trying to be the voice of. So I feel like, you know, if they're going to mention my last name, please mention all the human rights violations that are happening, not just in Turkey, in my home country, but all over the world.
I love that. And kind of going back to what you said earlier about you doing all these interviews to reach as wide of an audience as possible. Mm-hmm. I think that in a country nearly divided on every issue, what is your message to Americans across the political spectrum for why your pro-human rights advocacy and freedom messaging can be one of the few things that actually unifies the American people, unlike exactly. anything we've had in a long time?
Exactly. I mean, there is no right, left, or east, west in human rights. There is only one human race, and we need to, you know, stand up for those innocent people. And, you know, to me, it is important to, you know, amplify and bring awareness of what's going on, all the human rights violations, not just in Turkey, not just in China, but all over the world, you know? And whenever I go to Congress and sit down with this, you know, senators and congressmen and congresswomen, and I sit down with both sides. And whenever I sit down, I always tell them, like, listen, you know, I don't want to do politics. I don't want to, you know, take a picture and just post it out there so people will think that I'm from this side or that side. I really want to, like, bring awareness of what's going on and find a solution, not just talk about it, but be about it. You know what I mean? Because that's what we say in our locker room. But, you know, I sit down with both sides, and whenever I sit down, we have this good conversation about what kind of bills that we can come up with to help people, what kind of maybe, you know, the sanctions or something to do about Olympics and stuff. But I think it's important for people to understand, you know, just there's in human rights, there is no right or left wing. You know, there's only one message, and it's to help people, help the innocent people, help all the political prisoners out there, and help the people who are voiceless right now and waiting for help.
Yeah, and that's what I really respect about you, is that you are true to that freedom message, no mm-hmm. matter the political spectrum. You've sat down with Senator Warren, you've sat down with Senator Rubio, mm-hmm. and I believe you have a relationship with President Biden over your advocacy for Turkish human rights as well. And I think on top of that note, where we're talking about things that can unify the country, we saw the controversy with Afghanistan, where there was mm-hmm. that precipitous pullout, and now estimated millions of Afghanistans will die of starvation this winter. And with Russia on the move in Ukraine,
yeah.
what is your message to the Biden administration to do everything in its power to protect Taiwan from Chinese aggression after the previous administration failed to protect Hong Kong?
I'll just tell you this. You know, I remember first time, you know, Biden administration takes the office, they promised that they were going to prioritize human rights, because obviously before this summer, when they were taking office, I wasn't into this, you know, China topic. I was only focusing on Turkey, and I remember all my, you know, friends and all my, you know, people that I'm really close with were really happy because, you know, Biden went out there and said, we are going to, prioritize the human rights violations that are happening, not just in America, but all over the world. So people were really happy. And it's been how many years, days now, that what's going on in the world is just heartbreaking. Because as an immigrant, let me just tell you this, all the countries out there are seeing America as an example, seeing America as this country that where there is democracy, where there is freedom, where there is freedom of speech, religion, expression, press, right? And obviously, I feel like America should be the example of, you know, what they're doing to all over the world. And when they fail, obviously, it was breaking my heart. And it's been how many years now? I feel like America should definitely do something about all the human rights violations that are happening out there in the world. And I mean, I know I'm not an expert about other countries, but I am an expert in Turkey. I'll tell you this. I mean, right now, look at what Erdogan is doing to his people. And, you know, it's pretty much Turkey is the number one country in the world that put the most journalists in a jail. And there's so much political prisoner, innocent people are suffering, right? But just because of Turkey is a NATO ally, you know, and that America hasn't done anything yet, you know, and that's what I thought they would do when Biden's administration took the office. So, I mean, I'm still waiting. I'm still hopeful, I guess, but definitely America should be an example of a democracy.
And I totally agree with that perspective. And it's really interesting that you bring up Turkey as well as Chinese human rights abuses. You talked about Venezuela the other day, but mm-hmm. what exactly do you want to see the government do? What types of actions, like how far are you willing to take it to get people to support those human rights abroad?
I mean, there's so much things that they could do, you know, democratic reform, sanctions, I mean, stop buying slave labor items, diplomatic pressure, which they did in the Olympics. It's good. I don't know if it's good enough. You know, ban all the products coming to the U.S. from Xinjiang, which Biden administration just, signed a bill that if you are a company that if you cannot prove that you have nothing to do with slave labor, then it will be banned to come into the U.S., hold the shipments off the border of Xinjiang. So there's so many things that we could do, but we just need to do it.
And you did mention that the Congress, I believe it was a completely bipartisan effort to block mm-hmm. all exports from Xinjiang province. I'm sorry, imports. And you're seeing some of that sentiment where there's a lot of bipartisan support for holding mm-hmm. China accountable for these human rights. But why do you think that Democratic politicians have not displayed as hard of a public stance on China as they do on social issues that, may I say, they tend to extrapolate at home comparatively?
I was actually asking that question to my manager. And if you have any answer to that, I would love to hear it. And I have no idea. And I actually asked that question to my manager, I believe, 13 days ago. And he actually wanted to explain that to me. He tried, and I just couldn't understand it. So if you have a better answer, I would love to hear it.
So I'm asking the questions here. So I'm not exactly sure on this front.
That's the question I'm trying to find out the last 2 weeks, and I have no idea.
Maybe it has something to do with that sentiment where the stop anti-Asian hate, that hashtag, and you have certain Democrats that they kind of buy into the social justice messaging to the point where maybe they don't want to go after them because they don't want to appear racist, or there's that sentiment where they want to diminish the United States' role abroad as this force for intervening around the world and projecting its influence on others. Maybe it has something to do with that.
I should definitely do more research about it, but that's the question I've been trying to find out the last 2 weeks.
Yeah, and hopefully your message really does get across to them. And I do appreciate the work that you do reaching out to all types of people. I really think that that's going to be very important in just the fight for freedom worldwide. And kind of shifting a little bit, less political, but I want to know, you've said that morals, principles, and values, they're the most important thing in life, period. And I want to know what forces growing up as a child and adolescent in Turkey and later in the United States helped reinforce your values.
I remember when I was 9 years old, you know, my mom told me that, you know, stand up for the things, even if it, you know, means sacrificing everything you have. And I remember from that day forward, you know, I never was shy about talking the truth, even if it's, you know, hurts people's feelings, or even if it's cost me a lot. You know, I was like being always straightforward with people. And I grew up that way. And after I came to America, I was, you know, I slowly studied about what's going on in my home country, in Turkey, you know, Middle East, Europe, America. I started to study because I was just very, very interested. And I believe that this, you know, platform is given me by God, and I want to use it to do the, you know, God's work. So, you know, obviously after that, you know, I started with, you know, the issues are happening in Turkey. And I started back in 2013. And then just this summer, I started, you know, the paying attention about the human rights violations, not just happening in Turkey, but all over the world. And then I started to study about China. And then, I mean, I'm not done yet. I'm right now only like talked about, you know, a few countries, but I'm it's going to go more. I'm going to get to eventually every dictatorship in the world.
I love that. And is there potentially a Freedom Foundation on the way soon?
And many people asking me about it, like many, many people, but I will love to do that for sure.
And another thing that I'm kind of curious about with your upbringing is I did a lot of research on you and your background, and you mentioned God, you mentioned religion, and you went to a Gulen school growing up. And I believe your father was a Gulen supporter. And for a lot of people in the United States, they don't really care about foreign policy until it starts to affect them. So that's why I kind of want to dive into your background a little bit. And how has that movement influenced you? Can you explain what the Gulen movement is to our audience?
I remember, you know, going to the Gulen movement school since second grade. And because they were the best school in Turkey, I'm going to tell you a crazy fact, is even President Erdogan's kids went to prep school for in Gulen movement. And not many people know about that, actually. Well, the reason my family sent me to school because they wanted me to, you know, get the best education. And I learned a lot. And the reason I'm so open to, you know, dialogue and people, other religions and cultures, because of this schools. And, you know, after I came to, you know, America, I actually had a chance to meet with Mr. Gulen. I remember first time meeting him, you know, I was asking him, you know, some questions. He told me that something that really inspired me. He's like, it doesn't matter what your religion is, your culture, your skin color, where you're from, or your background. The most important thing in life is leave your differences on the table and try and find what we have in common. And obviously, we only have one world to live. We don't have a plan B right now. So we need to make this world better together. And this movement, the reason is I'm like so interested in this movement, because instead of going around and building mosques, this movement was going around and building schools and dormitories and universities and, you know, the education centers and dialogues centers. So if you look at what in this moment right now, over there are, you know, schools and, you know, education centers and cultural centers over 170 countries around the world, you know, and you are Muslim, if you're Christian, if you're Catholic, or if you're Jewish, or you believe in God, you don't believe in God, you know, you can go to the schools and learn about science and math. So that really like inspired me and got my attention.
Yeah, and for the audience that doesn't know, the Gulen movement in Turkey is it's more of a secular Muslim movement, or it's more focused on bringing an awareness of a broader education outside of just a religious context. And I believe your father is he's a professor at Istanbul University, and he was put in jail for being associated with the Gulen movement, apparently coming from the Turkish government.
Yeah.
So I kind of want to ask you about your background with your family, because many people don't know that you haven't even seen your family in years. I saw your tweet yesterday where you said happy birthday to your mother, and that really broke my heart.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'll tell you a quick story. It all started back in 2013. You know, there was a corruption scandal happened in Turkey. And that's the first time I said something about it, because President Erdogan and his family was involved in it. And just because of the obvious NBA platform, it became a conversation here in the United States and Turkey. And I was like, even like put a one tweet out that affects this much, I'm going to start paying attention about what's going on in my country more. So I started to study. I remember my teammates were going out to hang out and parties and all that stuff. I was going back home and study about, you know, foreign relations and Turkey and Turkish history, the relationship between America and Turkey. And more I was speaking about these issues, the big platform started to give me this huge, big outlets in America, even like started to give me this platform. And, you know, obviously whenever I say something or I give an interview, it was, you know, becoming viral, and Turkish government hated that. You know, my dad was a genetic professor. He got fired from his job. My sister went to medical school for six years. She still cannot find a job. My, you know, brother was playing basketball. He literally got kicked on every team because of the same last name. But they were getting affected so much, they had to put a statement out there and saying, we are disowning Enes, you know? But then, you know, Turkish government didn't believe that. They sent police to my house in Turkey and they took every electronics away. Phones, computers, laptops, iPads, because they wanted to see if I am still in contact with my family or not. And I wasn't. And they still, you know, took my dad in jail for a while. But we put so much pressure from here to Turkey, they let him go. And then obviously after that, they revoked my passport, put my name on Interpol list. They actually did try to kidnap me in Indonesia. And so it's been a very rough, you know, last eight years. But you know, the sad thing is, you know, people knows my story. Like even when I sit down and have a conversation with my teammates, they're like, dude, like, what are you doing? You know, your family is still back in Turkey. Like, why are you still talking about these issues? But like, I'm an NBA player. That's why people know my story. But there are so many, you know, people and families and stories out there. The situation is way worse than mine. So I'm trying to use my story and my platform to be the voice of all those innocent people out there, you know? So it was really important for me to talk about all this stuff. And that's the story.
And I thought that was amazing. Just even going back to 2017 when you were detained in the airport.
Yeah.
And where was that?
Romania.
It was Romania. Yeah. It was just an incredible story and just the journey you've been on. And I think maybe your teammates don't even understand, like when I feel like you have these passionate conversations where you're explaining to them like all the nuances of what's going on in Turkey or what's going on in China. And maybe they don't really understand because they grew up in America, extremely privileged. So when you talk about all these freedoms, maybe it kind of goes by the wayside for them.
You know, I will say this, obviously America having their own problems too. And no country out there, I guess, is perfect, but you know, when you are you know, living in countries like, you know, Turkey, China, North Korea, Belarus, Iran, Venezuela, Cuba, Russia, then you would feel blessed to be in this situation here in America, you know? And like I said, again, you have freedom of speech, religion, expression, freedom of press. You hate the president. You don't like, you love the president. You can say it out loud. You know, I remember, I'll tell you a quick, weirdest story. My manager's wife's dad liked one of my posts on, I believe it was on either Facebook or Twitter. He spent 14 days in jail. And people, when I tell the story to people, they just can't understand it, you know? The reason I'm not playing Turkish national team is because of my political views, you know? So it's like things can get really crazy. And I'm just keep telling, not just, you know, the people in NBA, but like all my athlete friends, you know, we should all feel blessed to be in this situation here in the United States.
Yeah, well, honestly, if you don't want to play for the Turkish national team, we'd love to have you on Team USA. That would be fantastic.
Trust me, I wish. I wish.
That'd be amazing. And I kind of want to get into basketball a little bit because I feel like you've gone all over the news. The past 2 months has been human rights, advocacy, and most of that audience is not really in tune with basketball or the NBA. And so many people don't really know you as well as a basketball player. So I'm wondering if you can discuss how you got into the game of basketball and when you fell in love with it.
I actually wanted to be a soccer player when I was growing up because it's like the number one sport in my country. You know, it's, you know, everybody loves soccer. And well, obviously I was too tall for it, too slow for it. And I switched to basketball. And I mean, many people don't know it, but I went to prep school here in the United States, Simi Valley, California. And I went to college in Kentucky. And that's where I learned the language, the culture, the people. And I went to school there. And I got drafted by, you know, Utah Jazz in 2011. And I played in Utah, you know, Oklahoma City, and New York, Boston, Portland. So I was pretty much like all over the country. So I know how people think or even how people speak in different, you know, part of the country. To me, it was really eye-opening because I really wanted to like visit and see all these people from different, you know, different side of the country that you will get a better understand of people. And, you know, it's my 11th year now in the league. I'm currently playing for the Celtics, which I have COVID right now. I've been stuck in my house the last 8 days. I got 2 days, I guess, left. And I'll be going out there and playing basketball, I hope. But other than that, yeah, that's my story. That's my basketball story.
And yeah, I forgot to even mention that to our audience that you are in the COVID protocols right now. How are you feeling? Are you feeling a lot better?
I feel good. I mean, I'm triple vaccinated, still got the COVID somehow, still quarantining. It's been 8 days now that I've been stuck in my house.
Wow, that's crazy. So maybe if you've had so much time to be in your house, I'm wondering, have you thought about what your New Year's resolution is going to be this year?
Oh man, good question. I think just learn more and listen more. You know, I feel like sometimes, especially people in my platform loves talking, but I feel like we need to listen more, you know, and because so we can learn. And I'm open to like, I'm open to learn. I love learning. I feel like the important thing is just sit down and listen both sides of the people. And hear what they have to say, and then you can decide. But other than that, I definitely want to read more books and watch more documentaries. And that's what I have been trying to do the last 8 days. I actually recently watched this show on Netflix called How to Become a Tyrant. And you see some of the mindset, because I mean, obviously, if you're going to fight, then you need to know your enemies. And so I've been just watching this Netflix show, and it's been crazy.
And on that note, where people should try and listen and learn, I think that you're someone that can really be learned from. And I think that's what a lot of people have been drawn to you about, is just learning about all these things that are happening around the world, whether it's in China or Venezuela or back in your home country. And so what I'm wondering is, this past few years has been extremely challenging in the United States and the world. And What is your message in terms of encouraging our viewers and the rest of the world to stay more positive and work towards a more free and prosperous future?
I feel like, you know, just obviously there, you look at the world right now, it's been crazy the last couple of years, you know? And I feel like the important thing is like, we need each other more than anything, you know? And then when you look at a person before, oh, he's from this, he's from this side, he's from this color, but we need to focus on us. And we need to ask that question to ourselves, how can I make this, or how can we make this country better? How can I make this world better together with my friends out there? You know, that's the question that we've been trying to find out in our locker room the whole time. I feel like the message should be unity and love and compassion, you know? And I feel like, I mean, right now you look at the world, I mean, it's been a crazy last 2 years. I feel like all we need to do is just rely on each other and just pray God to just, you know, just stay safe and healthy and try to do best we can to just not drive ourselves crazy.
Yeah. And on that note, if you're thinking about starting the Freedom Foundation, I'd be more than happy to give you my free Hong Kong jersey as the first auction item.
I actually love that, man. I don't know if you were following the news just 2 days ago. There was another crackdown on the free media in Hong Kong by the Hong Kong government. And it just that Free Hong Kong obviously started 2 years ago and became a huge news, and people are scared to say it, especially more athletes. But I feel like whenever we see a crackdown on a free press or freedom of speech or, you know, expression, we should definitely raise our voice. And actually, one of my friends, Denise Ho, she was a pop star, and she got arrested. And they let her go, I believe, today. But it just sad to see this Chinese government keep abusing people's rights, and the world just stayed silent over it. So,
but I think that kind of goes back to the culture war issues we're talking about, where Americans, they don't really care about foreign policy until it impacts them. It's about what the issues of the day are, how can we keep our narrative going? And it's just this constant back and forth. And that's where I kind of feel like you're being pulled by both sides to kind of repeat that narrative. And that is where those issues, they do get lost. No one's really talking about what happened with the pro-democracy newspaper that got, they got canned in Hong Kong. Seven journalists were put into jail. That singer that you mentioned, I saw that article as well. And it's just really a shame. So I hope that going forward in 2022, like you said, people can really soak up that message of freedom and really look outward and listen and just really take onus of their world.
No, for sure, man. I am with you. You know, people are suffering around the world, and there's so much political prisoners, and there's so much, you know, people needs help. And I feel like America should be definitely the leader and just go out there and just say, hey, you know, this is not how you do it. And be the example of democracy and freedom around the world.
Yeah, and on that note, Ennis, you've given us so much time, and I really want to sincerely thank you for joining the program, and your just advocacy has been a beacon of hope for millions around the world. And I sincerely wish you the best of luck in continuing to be the leading voice in the fight for freedom worldwide. And I want to thank you, Mr. Freedom, and God bless you.
I'm still trying to get used to that last name. I appreciate that.